Hallo? Okay. Well, welcome to the physical security workshop. Mark Seiden from the US and myself, I'm Barry, we'll do this workshop. It will be two completely different approaches of physical security, but you will see that. I will start off. My name is Buddy Wells. I'm the founder of Tool, which is a lockpick sport group. We are based in Amsterdam and we focus on lock security for fun, but also because we're really, really interested in that. The organization in Germany is called SSDEF. You can see them downstairs. They have ongoing lockpick workshops, championships. It's a very great force of knowledge, these two organizations. A lot of people focus on one small part, find something interesting, share it with a group of people. By now it's like 1,500 people who are into this sport, who are into this physical security as a hobby. And it's amazing what people can pull off, and I hope to demonstrate some techniques that I hope will amaze you. When I visited my friends from the German group a couple of months ago, there was a demonstration by a person called Klaus Noch. He's a German guy, and he found out a trick to open locks which is known for 50 years, but nobody seemed to understand the real implications of it or how to use it exactly. And if you know how to use this technique exactly, you can open 80, maybe 90% of all the locks, all the normal pin tumbler locks, with very little knowledge, under 30 seconds most of the time, and I will try to explain how. First of all, you need to know how a lock works. Now let's see if I can... Oh, and we need a laser pointer that we can control, not that you will point for me. Does anybody in this audience have a laser pointer? Ah, there we go. My friend Paul Wouters. Give him an applause. Okay, this part of the session worked, so now if everything else goes as smoothly as this, I'll be very happy. Let's see, how do I... space. Well, there you go. It's not Windows. Space, you said.
Spacebar.
Yeah, spacebar. Hey, hey, hey.
Backspace.
No. No, no, no. This is not going well. No. Okay, there we go. Hey. Okay, well, at least now people cannot blame Windows. That's a good thing. Anyway, how many of you people know exactly how a normal pin tumbler lock works? Okay, well, that's about 50%, I would say. For the other 50%, I will try to explain. When you insert a key into a lock, what happens is that a set of pins, and that's that. This is a cutaway view of a lock, and if you insert the key correctly, and the key is the correct key to the lock, there's two rows of pins, five stacks of pins, that the point where the pins are on top of each other needs to be in one straight line, namely the line where the inner cylinder and the outer cylinder touch each other, and that's a little bit complicated. I do have a cutaway lock. Let's see. Yeah, it's still in my bag. But you could, and here is the lock when it's tilted a little bit. You can see here the lower pins, and here are the upper pins that are spring-loaded. But a lock is nothing more than a collection of two pins that are stacked on each other with a little spring that keeps them under tension. And if you insert the key, and the key is the correct one, all the lower pins are aligned in the exact position, and then the lock can turn. If one of these pins sticks out too high or too deep, the lock cannot turn because it will be jammed by these pins. I hope people understand this concept. A lot of people are shaking yes, so thank you. Okay. Now, this is an interesting concept, because how do you pick a lock, for instance? Well, what you do is you put the lock under tension, so you want to turn the lock. The pins are not in the correct position, but the pins all have a small tolerance, a small mechanical... how do you call it, Mark? They're very small differences. So, and normally you exploit a lock opening like that, but this is not what this technique is about. This technique is about Newton's law. And you already saw the second slide. How many people know this device, the Newton's cradle with the balls? I found some video, and this guy actually did something clever. He dressed himself in black when... Oh, there we go. How do I turn this video on?
You click on the black shirt.
I click on the black shirt. Hey, there we go. Okay, everybody seems to know it, but this is what happens. The energy of the ball on the left is being transferred through all the other balls and is being transferred to the outside ball, which, when it bounces back, transfers some energy back. But what counts for this new opening technique is the fact that energy is being transferred through metal objects to the last part where there is nothing that holds it, and then the energy will come free and move that object. And this is something very important to understand in what I'm going to tell next. This can be also used with locks. Now, locksmiths know for, I think, 50 or 60 years the joy of a so-called lockpick gun. That's this one. This, by the way, is a special lockpick gun that's modified by Kurt Schulke to also operate on European locks. You can operate it upside down or the normal way around. That's because pins in Europe are so-called upside down, and pins in the US are the correct way, as they call it. Anyway, and here's an ancient version of a pick gun called the snapper gun, and you can actually, from a piece of metal and little practice, make a tool like this yourself. Just bend it and hit it with a hammer and grind it down a little bit, and you'll have a tool that will open locks for a few times, because then the wire breaks. And but anyway, how does it work? If you see this needle here with the pick gun and with the snapper gun, what you do is you insert it into the lock and you reach all the five lower pins. You tilt, you lift the pick gun till you feel that you actually are hitting all five lower pins at the same time. You pull the trigger, and when you pull the trigger, the needle of the pick gun will actually transfer some impact energy. It will go click, and it will hit up or down, depending on if it's a European lock or not. Once it does that, the lower pins will stay in place, as we learned. The lower pins will stay in place, and the energy is being transferred, just like the Newton's cradle. It's being transferred through the first pin to the second pin. The second pins, all five of them, will jump up because of the energy that's being transferred by this needle. And at the moment they're jumping up, there's a gap. And that's the gap we need to turn the lock. So if you have a pick gun, you just insert it into the lock, make sure you hit all five pins at the same time. You insert something called a tensioner, which it's a small metal piece that you use to rotate the lock at the moment that the gap is there. So, this has been used by locksmiths for over 50 years, and it still works on 50% of all the locks. If you ever lose your key, or if you ever lost your key, you might have seen one of these pick guns, because it's what pros use on a daily basis to open doors. Now, the lock industry tries to defeat that, and what they did was... What they did was, to tease us a little bit, is design keyways that are very, very narrow. This is an FA lock. It's a pretty high security lock. And why is it high security? Because the keyway goes zigzag from one side to the other. And it's practically impossible to insert the needle of a pick gun or to insert lockpick tools into this keyway. So it was until a little while virtually pick-proof. It was very, very difficult to pick it, especially since the pins can be very long or very short. So sometimes you need to lift pins very high end. Sometimes you barely have to touch them. And if you have a combination in your lock that's high-low, high-low, it's very difficult to defeat it. However, with the new technique that we learned, namely bumping, I consider bump keys the biggest threat in physical security that I've learned of in a long, long, long time, because it can open almost any lock I've seen so far with very little knowledge and practice. Together with my friend Rob Hongrijp, I wrote a white paper about it, how it technically works. I will show you the URL at the end of the demonstration. But what you see here is actually a bunch of so-called bump keys or 999 keys. Why 999? If you have a key copy machine from a key copy shop that can computer cut keys, the deepest cut in a key normally is the 9, meaning that if you set your key copy machine to 99999, it will copy this key. It will cut as deep as the, it will cut all pins as deep as the tolerances normally are, or as the spacing normally is. And you can see here a bunch of 999 keys, so these are all cut to the deepest. And as you can see, there's also some special keys, but I will get to that. Let's see. So what's special about the bump key? I mean, that you can make a key that's 999, okay, great. But what is this about? What is this about is, first I will have to explain a little bit about how a key normally works. What's important with a key is the so-called shoulder. The shoulder is the point sticking out that will prevent the key entering the lock deeper than a certain position. If you ever went to a key copy shop and they messed up your keys, 9 out of 10, they put the shoulder in a wrong position, meaning that the cuts that normally lift pins to a certain angle were in the wrong position and therefore your lock didn't open. So it's very important that the shoulder, compared to the cuts, is in the right position. Well, this high security dome lock is now cut to 999. These are the cuts. And what we do with bump keying is we take off half a millimeter of this shoulder. So if I normally insert this 999 key into a lock, not a whole lot will happen. The cuts will hit the lower pins. They will just be there. The pins are not even lifted. It will just make contact with the pins. Nothing happens. But what we do is we take off half a millimeter of the shoulder. And then what happens is that you get this spacing here, as you can see on this picture. There's a small spacing, meaning that if I now press the key into the lock, I feel actually that the pins are lifted a little bit, because the angle of the cut in the key will hit the pin and try to lift it up just a fraction. And the more I take off the shoulder, the more it will move. But the trick is half a millimeter, maybe even quarter of a millimeter. A very, very tiny fraction of the shoulder needs to be taken off. And also, you take off a small part of the tip of the key, but I will get into that a little later. Now, for bump keying, you need a hammer. What we're going to do is, once the key that can go half a millimeter deeper into the lock than normal, once we insert it and we hit it with a hammer, a lot of energy is being put in the lock. And the only way that the energy that went in can come out is through the upper 5 pins. And it doesn't matter how hard I hit it, the energy has to go somewhere, and it will go through the lower pins into the upper pins. There will be a big shear line and the lock will open. This works on, as I mentioned before, well, maybe 90% of all the locks. There are some sidebar locks that resist this type of attack, but I will demonstrate a few locks that people might think, well, you can't possibly open this lock. Yeah, we'll see about that. This hammer, by the way, is a special hammer designed again by Kurt Schulke, who I'm a big fan of. Yeah, it's just a plastic hammer with a little plastic weight on it, and it's very, very, very effective. I'm happy I brought two because 30 minutes before the workshop, my original hammer broke, and this is my backup. So, yeah. Well, then I will now start the demonstration, and then people will say, "But you possibly cannot open this type of lock." Well, let's see how far I get. Can you hook up the camera for me? Good. We will start with the very difficult keyway of Eva, the zigzag motif. What's that? I don't hear what he says.
The mouse cursor.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. Excuse me. Okay, anyway. Anyway, this is a lock that normally is very difficult to pick. This is the bump key that we made for it, and as you can see, it's cut to the deepest. Well, I took off some of the tip, as you can probably see, it's a little flat, and not sure if I can open it on camera, but I'll try.
Everybody wants to be a movie director.
Open. So this is your standard 5-pin lock that people who spent a more than normal amount of money put on their door. Now I go to the next level. It's a 7-pin lock, a so-called dimple lock or Bormulden shoots, whatever they call it in German. And it's from Multilock. They make several types of locks, and this is the easiest one they got. The little plastic you see here is actually designed by Oliver Diedrichsen, who sits over there and tries to be anonymous, but I spotted him anyway. But what he actually did is use some hot glue to make sure that the key would not enter the lock too deep. There is no shoulder on this type of key. So what he did was use some hot glue to make sure that the key wouldn't enter too much. Let's see if I can open it. It doesn't even want to enter the lock. Now, the problem with bumping is that these locks sometimes are destroyed. Oh, there goes my demo. Does anybody have a lockpick with them? I need to turn the pin a little bit. It's dented from all the blows. Okay, I'll go to the next one in the meanwhile. This. Okay.
There is no software used in this demo.
Okay, well, we'll forget about this lock then. It's too bad. This lock that I didn't open had 7 pins, and the 7 pins were all from the top. But there's also locks that have pins from multiple sides. For instance, there's a lock called Linse. It's this one. It has 10 pins, 5 pins from the top, 5 pins from the bottom. And when I asked the person operating the key machine to make me a bump key for this lock, he said, well, what's the combination that you want? 6 is the deepest I can cut with this lock. I said, well, make it 666 on one side and 666 on the other side. And he did that, and guess what? He cut through the key. So it seems that if there's a cut 6 on one side, on the other side, it's not allowed to go deeper than a cut 4. If you do that, you cut through the key. I entered it into the lock and thought, what the heck? And voila. There's even locks that have 15 pins. Now, this game goes on and on and on. But this is actually what it looks like. It's got pins everywhere from 3 sides. I'll give it a try. Open. Now, there are two higher levels than these two locks, or than these locks that I demonstrated. And the thing is, I've been practicing 1 hour before when I broke my hammer. And there's two locks that are even more high. And one is the... it's turned on. But at least we know how to make you laugh. Anyway, one of the most high secure locks at this moment, or at least that's what people like to believe, is the multi-lock interactive. It's a pin-in-pin system, meaning that instead of normally there are 2 pins in a lock, here are 4, meaning that the lower pin is hollow and contains a second, smaller, thinner pin inside that pin. The pin-in-pin system is overestimated for a long time, although I'm not allowed to say that. I was on Dutch television at prime time in some news show, and somebody gave me one of these locks, and I couldn't open it for an hour. So what am I to say? And the same thing could happen here, because I've had quite some success opening this multi-lock interactive, but I have no idea if, 1,000 people watching or how many there are now, if it works or not. I'll give it a try for 1 minute. If it doesn't work, we'll see how I try to back off. Open. Okay, I'm happy that the score now is multi-lock 1, Barry 1. Okay, and then there's another lock that I personally never, ever, ever dreamed of opening with any lockpick tools whatsoever. We lockpickers sometimes have a favorite lock that we really, really like. And the Asa Twin, it's a sidebar lock which has 6 normal straight pin tumblers, as in a classic original pin tumbler system, but also the sidebar, which is the combination below here. That sidebar mechanism is so ingenious, it's very, very hard to pick it, and I would call this lock pick-proof, It's in use by a lot of governments, a lot of big corporations, and this is about the most secure lock, about the most secure lock you could buy, until this discovery. The weak spot about this ASA twin, as what it's called, is that the sidebar combination, which actually is the mechanism that makes it very difficult to pick or very difficult to manipulate, even with bumping, is it works with solid pins, and it goes too deep into technical detail to explain exactly how it works. But if the sidebar combination is unknown, bumping doesn't work with this type of lock. However, to make it easy for key copy shops or whatever, or key shops, is that normally they sell these sidebars in regions. So for instance, in Berlin, the code is 954. I'm not sure if you can read it. That means that if you go to a Berlin copy shop or a Berlin key shop that sells ASA Twin, 9 out of 10 will probably sell you the 954 sidebar combination, which is this combination. So the thing that makes the lock so strong actually works against them if you can buy the same lock as your neighbor. If I know that my neighbor bought a lock in the area, I can buy a lock at the same shop, got the same sidebar combination, cut it to 999 and open it. Now, this lock is an 80 euro lock, and I opened it, I think, 100 times. And the problem is, and I don't know if you can see it, you can see it here, the lock dents at one moment in time. It's a steel lock. It's a very, very nice, very strong lock. But it breaks when you bump it over 100 times. I will give it a try to see if it opens. Again, I will take 1 minute for that, not any longer than that. If it works, great. If it doesn't work, I'll go into a little bit more detailed technique of why it works and how it works. But let's first see how far I get. Open. Okay. I'm not sure if there are locks of gods, but they're in my... Yeah, whatever. Okay. Now, what we found out during examining what exactly goes on is that the more expensive a lock is, the more tight, the more, the less play there is in the lock, normally, the more difficult it is to manipulate. If you want to pick a lock that has got very high tolerances, it's very difficult. But with this technique, you transfer the energy, and if energy gets lost because pins have got too much space in the chambers or whatever, it doesn't work. So this technique works best on expensive locks. there's nothing that I can do about that, but I personally thought it was very funny to find out that the more expensive a lock is and the more work that they put into engineering it as tightly as possible, the more easy it opens with bumping. So this basically is what bumping is all about. The white paper is online. It's on tool.nl/bumping.pdf. But as I said, it will be at the end of the show. We will show it to you. As I mentioned, there's only a few locks that resist this technique. And for instance, mechanical locks, magnetic locks, locks that use magnets to control the opening mechanism, they are resistant against this. And a few other high security cylinders, especially with sidebars. 9 out of 10 sidebars is the code word. But then, of course, only if the sidebar is not sold in every shop in the same region for the same time. So this is the thing about bumping that I wanted to say. Are there any questions so far? Where can you get the hammer? I paid 10 euros. So that's not too much. People use the wooden handle of a hammer, just the handle itself. Or people use the end of a screwdriver. There's many things that you can use to hit the lock. But personally, my big favorite is this this tomahawk hammer. Maybe you can make something yourself. I don't know.
Do you know if we can detect this kind of specific attack on the on the lock with a forensic study?
We tried to do it with the naked eye and with a magnifier and see if we could detect if pins were hit with the bump key or if not. So we opened so we opened the lock 10 times with bump keying, took it apart, and we took the same lock apart, and with the naked eye and with a magnifier we couldn't find it, although I'm 100% sure that the real forensic expert will definitely be able to see it, because the amount of force that the hammer puts onto these pins really is bigger than you should expect. Sometimes you miss the key and you hit your finger and then you realize how much... Oh. Any more questions? One more.
Are you explaining attacks against the magnetic locks later on, and are you recommending or suggesting which locks to buy to prevent attacks?
Well, if you would have asked me 6 months ago what lock should I buy, I probably would have said an ASA Twin would be a pretty safe choice. But although with my company, I'm sort of making sure that no people come into the building without being noticed. I mean, if they break in the door, that's fine. Well, it's not fine, but then at least we know that we got a visitor. Our locks have to be tamper resistant, so we have multiple layers. But we don't use the ASA Twin, we use something called Abloy, which is actually, it works with discs instead of pins. And it's called Abloy, A-B-L-O-Y. But you can look into that. But normally I've learned not to suggest any locks to anybody, because if it fails, people complain with me and it's free advice. So, more questions? Ah, one more. Yeah.
Where can you get the 999 keys?
You have to be friends with a locksmith. So yeah, you could either try it with some flowers or chocolate or... Okay, then we leave the questions for next. Mark, if you would be so kind to remove your laptop, because I'm going to demonstrate something very dangerous.
Okay. How far do I have to go?
All the way. Oh. Okay. Okay, it's distance. Yeah, you might think that I'm joking, but actually I'm not. On the same workshop where I learned about bump keying, yeah, now we can show the slides. Wonderful. Excellent. Okay, I'll show you the slides later.
Yeah, let me put it on the floor here. Push past this down.
Okay. On the same workshop in Germany, I learned about something else. I remember well that about 1.5 years ago, I visited a friend of mine at his company, and he looked at me with a big smile and said, "You're this clever lockpicking guy, aren't you? Now pick this." And he showed me... What's that? Well, hold on. Take care. And he showed me this plastic key with a blue tip, or no, with the blue handle. And it's known as the Winkhaus blue chip. And the Winkhaus blue chip is something that's the next generation in locks. And they're very proud of this technique. And people who know me and who know my background know that...
Sorry.
Anyway, people who know me and my background know that I'm into encryption and crypto. And when I first learned about this lock, I was really impressed. Because what it does is it uses 128-bit encryption to secure your locks and doors, which is pretty impressive. What it does is, in the tip of this key, there is a small RFID challenge response type of chip. It's wireless, and as you can see here on this fuzzy image, as soon as you insert it into the lock, it will do a challenge response, 128-bit, with the small microprocessor that's built into this lock, which is, you know, a big deal by itself to miniaturize it this way that it all works well. If the challenge response is right, cryptographical challenge response, there's a small pin here that's being pulled down, and if it's pulled down, the lock can rotate. And this really is a very clever design. And the people of... What?
Oh, sorry. All sorts of stuff going on here.
Okay. Anyway, Mark is making sure that you're not falling asleep. But anyway, I was impressed and pissed off that my friend told me, you know, you cannot open this lock, and I knew that he was right. That was until I visited my German friends, and what did I see? I saw actually a blue chip, a Winkhaus blue chip lock. And what else did I see? They had the key that does not operate the lock. So there's no transponder in this key, it's a blank key, it's a demo key. And if you insert it into the lock, it will turn 45 degrees, but then the pin will prevent it from turning. Now, nice and well. What did somebody find out? And here's where the dangerous stuff happened. Okay, this here is a very strong magnet. And I'm not kidding that it's very strong. If you buy it, it comes in a box, and the box has a big skull and bones on it saying, beware. It's also called in German the Todesmagnet. This has got multiple reasons. One is that it will destroy any hard drive that it comes nearby. It will destroy your credit cards. One magnet has got 85 kilograms of pulling strength. So if somebody weighs 80 kilos, supposedly, he could hang on the magnet. This is a very strong magnet, and it's very dangerous. It's also dangerous for another reason. If this desk was made out of metal and I would be here and demonstrating the magnet, it would jam. Once it grips, it would smash my fingers, and I wouldn't pick locks for a little while. So so you've got to be careful with this type of stuff. Now, what this guy found out is... I told you. I'm not sure if you can see it, but... Now, this magnet can be bought for 39 euros. And the lock is a 250 euro lock. Yeah, and you might think it's funny, but I can tell you that the company Winkhaus did a pretty bad job fixing their problem. And I will first put this away. Okay, Winkhaus did a pretty bad job fixing the problem. They know about it for at least 6 months, and then there was the so-called security show in Essen, which is a very, very big trade show, and they had this big stand that was almost the size of a football field, and 100 meters away from that stand was a stand of a guy called Wendt, Mr. Wendt, who sells lockpick tools, and he was demonstrating to everybody who wanted to see that you could open this expensive lock with a magnet. So they had this huge stand, And they were making a fool out of themselves because they'd known it for at least 4 months, is what I've been told. And they tried to put it under the carpet, as we call it in Dutch. I don't know if it's an English expression, but they tried to put it under the rug. So as soon as the security showed, these people started to demonstrate it in the open that the lock could be this easily defeated. They had to do something. So they made a security alert. They opened a hotline in Germany, not in Holland. They opened a hotline in Germany saying, all our customers who read this, contact us. I would do it the other way around. I would try to contact my customers and say, we have a problem and we will fix this for you. But they say, well, if you read this, you're in trouble. And then 2 weeks after the show was over, so was the web page. They pulled the links. We found that the document containing the warning was still there, but there's nothing that reminds of this big gap. Now, with Tool, we got a lot of people visiting us, including, for instance, a big multinational in Holland who had a problem with their physical locks. And I explained them what their problem actually was. They had problems with people stealing some stuff from them, and they had no idea how these locks were opened. It seemed that it was pretty easy, but they couldn't figure out how it was done. And then the guy said with a big smile, well, at least our factory is secure now because we have these computerized locks. I said, is it blue? And then his face turned white. And he looked at me shaking, said, you are kidding. And I said, well, unfortunately, I'm not. And I didn't have one of these magnets, but I shot some video. And when he saw the video, he got really, really angry because they just installed it very recently because they had some problems, people stealing stuff. To the highest level of the board of directors, all the locks were changed with this blue chip lock. And now he found out that with 39 euros, people could bypass it. So he got angry, sent an angry email or called to Winkhaus and said, what's going on? And they sent back the lamest reply I have ever seen. Yeah, we tested it with ferrite magnets and the other magnet is a very special, dangerous, blah. 39 euros, you can buy it on supermagnets.ch. But they said, in January, we have good news, in January we will fix your problem. For 9 euros, we will upgrade your lock, and we will build into your locks that you send us. So when the locks are in transport, you maybe have to hire a guard, or I don't know. But when they get your locks, they will upgrade them, and they will build in some mechanism that you can see that people use the magnet to open it. So you buy this 250 euro lock per lock, eh? I mean, big plans and big... also, my friend from the multinational found another big multinational that uses the same locks, got the same upset reaction, and this was maybe 2 months ago. In the meanwhile, I tried to buy one of these locks from Winkhaus, and they didn't want to sell it to me for obvious reasons. But the guy from the multinational gave me the one that was on the board of directors room. I could have that because it had to be changed immediately. And then recently for my company, I visited some people that do VIP protection service, and they protect the Fortune 500 people in the Netherlands. And he Googled my name just as the first step of a small security clearance. And when he Googled my name, he found Tool, and he asked what it was about. And then I told him some stuff, and I told him about, how we tell people that some locks are not safe. And I told him about the blue chip, and then he said, there was one of his big clients that just had his whole villa changed. So there was an emergency call made. And I mean, this is a few months after the security show in Essen. Customers are not aware of this problem. I hope maybe this workshop will contribute that they will get their act together and do something serious about it and not make a detector for 9 euros that you can see that your whole warehouse was robbed with a magnet.